Amen. Jesus said, he who believes in me, out of him will flow rivers of living water. That I have come to give you not just life, but I have come to give you abundant life, more than ordinary life, life that thrives. Amen. So this morning, let's greet one another. We all should be full of coffee and stuff, so it would be easy to find one another.
It's the complete opposite.
I know.
Everybody's like,
All the sugar.
Maybe.
Sugar high now, they're getting ready to sink. What am I, chop liver? Didn't stop any of the white.
Would he be embarrassed? And just leave it. Yeah, you almost just want to let him go. Did you take chorus?
Just a chorus.
It's to know you and to me.
Sean's, get up here.
Good morning, everyone. It is great to be here this morning. If you are a guest with us today, my name is Sean Austin, and no, I am not the pastor here. I am Sean, but I'm not Sean. If you guys can gather that. No, I spell mine right. Anyway, if you are a guest with us today, we actually have, in the bulletin today, we have an insert here where you can tear off and you can fill out and we can have a record for your visit. And also what is unique to our church is that we take time to share our praises and what God has been doing in our lives. So with that being said, are there any praises today? Of course. 30 years ago, woo! 30 years of marriage. Oh. Amen.
That's praise in itself. It was great to see teams of people walk through this church this morning and pray for each and every room in the church. Something that we've lacked for so long, and not us, but Christians as a whole, is faithful and continual prayer. So thank you for coming this morning. Thank you for walking through this church. Thank you for praying. And don't let today just be an anomaly. Continue to pray for this church.
Amen. 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 Awesome. Awesome. That's awesome. Are there any other praises today? Okay. Awesome. Awesome. Yes, Russ.
When our family goes out to lunch a lot, we'll keep track. And then I know when somebody's been out here Well, we go to IHOP pretty frequently, and there was a
food
waitress there by the name of Kate. And she waited on us for a long time, and I gave her tracks and talked and prayed and get to the new thing that we prayed for. Well, Friday night we went there, and we had another waitress wait on us, Abby, and I gave her a track. But when I went out to get them, because I forgot to bring them in, the Holy Spirit said, take two. And I said,
awesome. Wow. Praise God. Any praise reports back here?
I think it's coming from Kinva. Amen.
Jeremy? Yes, prayer is important, and prayer does work. And we have a lot to be thankful for. Yes. Amen. Amen. Awesome. Wow. Praise God. It's important for us to share this together as a church, all that God is doing. And God is doing a lot in this church. Thank you. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, thank you for this day. Thank you for all that you're doing. Thank you for all the praise reports that were lifted up today. I thank you that you are providing for us and that you are just doing great things throughout this city of Topeka and throughout this church in Maranatha. Lord, I pray that you will continue being in this service, that you will continue inviting us into your presence, and that we'll be hearers. And Lord, speak through me today as you've laid a message on my heart. I pray that it will not be my words, but they will be your words. And I pray also for the worship team that their songs that we sing will be glorifying to you, and that we will just be being together as a body. And in Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Amen. A whole lot of praising going on. Let's stand and continue to worship this morning.
Over the mountains and the sea, your river runs with love for me. And I will open up my heart and let the hearer set me free. I'm happy to be in the truth. Sing of your love.
songs will never stop. This next song obviously is dedicated to our Lord, who we praise and worship this morning, with a little tweak to the ACLU. If our God is for us, who can stand against us? Not the ACLU. Amen.
Oh, what a foretaste, glory divine.
Witness lots of miracles from our great God this week, have we not? And if we have learned anything this week, we have learned that despite the fact that we are not always faithful, that we don't always do it perfect, that we stumble, God is always faithful. God always shows up. He's just asking for obedient service. And as we do that, He promises to be faithful, and He always is. Amen.
Change.
Amen. Father, we pause this morning. We pause to thank you for who you are, Father God. Again, there was no reason for you to look upon us, Lord, but you did. We're the apple of your eye. You love us, Father God, with all your heart. God, while we were yet sinners, while we were still prodigals, while we were running, you died for us. You came to seek us out. Father, we are not faithful, but you are so faithful. God, we lack power, but you have all power. And so, Father God, we fall on our knees before you this morning. Father God, we lift you up. We give you honor. We give you praise because you are worthy of all praise. God, may our music, may our words, may our thoughts be glorifying to you this morning, Father God. And we just pray for Brother Sean as he comes to bring your message. Father God, we pray that you would use him, that you would speak through him, and that above all else, Father, that everything that we do or say this morning gives you praise and honor. In Jesus' name, amen.
How many here? Oh, am I on? Am I on? All right, here I am. How many here are familiar with the film and musical Les Miserables? Raise your hands. Les Miserables. Yeah. It's one of my favorite movies of all time. It's one of my favorite musicals of all time. There's a character in there named Jean Valjean. He's the main character, and there comes a point in the film where he volunteers for the French Revolution, but not for the purpose of fighting in the revolution, but for the purpose of protecting a young man named Marius. And Marius happens to be in love with his adopted daughter, and his adopted daughter, Cosette, happens to be in love with the young man. And so when he realizes this, he decides to go into the battle to protect him or to ensure his safety. And during the break period between the fighting, because it's a musical, he decides to sing. And the song that he sings is Bring Him Home, and it's a prayer over the young man. Let's take a look at that.
Have known if God had granted me a son, the son must die one by one. How soon they fly on and on, and I am old and will be gone. Can't take your let him be. Let him live. If I die, let me die. Let him live. Bring him home.
I always love that scene, and whenever I get through the end of the movie, that's actually to the point I start getting emotional. But after watching most of it, but what a great picture it shows the love and care that he has. And the reason I share it is because we all know someone who we are praying for, who may be far from God for their own personal causes and desires, and that prayer is a calling for God to bring someone home. And today maybe you're thinking of someone. Today maybe you are that person who is far from God. The reason I share this is for that purpose, because we all know someone who is far. But the sermon series that we'll be going through the next few weeks comes from Luke chapter 15. And it's over Jesus' Lost Trilogy, as I like to call it. Popular culture in the movies and book distribution, there's a bunch of franchises, there are a bunch of trilogies. And Jesus has his own trilogy. And that's where these parables are found. His parables were always simple, they were always emotionally gripping, and they were also applicable. They understood them completely because they were relatable. And the Lord has laid on my heart a message about pursuing the lost. That's what this series is about. But I'm not going to start where he starts. I'm not going to start where Jesus starts, because I feel like maybe we need to be in a place to where we need to be able to genuinely pursue the lost, especially if we ourselves are far from God. And that's why today I'll be starting backwards. I'm going to start with the prodigal son and move to the lost coin, and then move to the lost sheep. Not in one message, just so you know. I'd be here until 3 o'clock, and I don't think you want to hear me talk that long. but that's where we will be. I feel like we are, as a church, are in a place where we are uncomfortable in our seats. We're uncomfortable just sitting on our butts in pews. We're ready to move. And as I've been hearing today, with all the praises, with people giving gospel tracts, with the event that happened this week, I can see that we are ready to be on a move. But some of us, it's been on my heart that maybe it's just me, but maybe we need to make sure that we are getting our hearts right with the Lord. So the question today is, are you far from God, and do you need to come home? Jesus refers to his examples as lost. Maybe they're just runaways as well. And that's why I'm entitling this series The Runaways. And so that's where we will be at today. So if you open your Bibles to Luke chapter 15, we will be starting with the prodigal son, starting in verse 11 through 32. And he said, a man had two sons. The younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the share of the estate that falls to me. So he divided his wealth between them. And not many days later, the younger son gathered everything together and went on a journey into a distant country. And there he squandered his estate with loose living. Now when he had spent everything, a severe famine occurred in that country, and he began to become impoverished. So he went and hired himself out to one of the citizens of that country, and he sent him into the fields to feed swine. And he would have gladly filled his stomach with the pods that the swine were eating, and no one was giving anything to him. But when he came to his senses, he said, "How many of my father's hired men have more than enough bread? But I am dying here with hunger. I will get up and go to my father, and I will say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me as one of your hired men.' So he got up and came to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and felt compassion for him. He ran to him, embraced him, and he kissed him. And the son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight. I am no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his slaves, 'Quickly, bring out the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and sandals on his feet, and bring the fattened calf, kill it, and let us celebrate. For the son of mine was dead and has become to life again. He was lost and has been found.' And they began to celebrate. Now his older son was in the field, and when he came and approached the house, he heard music and dancing. And he summoned one of his servants and began inquiring what these things could be. And he said to him, 'Your brother has come, and your father has killed the fattened calf because he has received him back safe and sound.' But he became angry and was not willing to go in, and his father began to plead with him. But he answered and said to his father, 'Look, for so many years I have been serving you, and I have never neglected a commandment of yours, and yet you have never given me a young goat so that I might celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours came, who has devoured your wealth with prostitutes, you have killed the fattened calf for him?' And he said to him, 'Son, you have always been with me, and all that is mine is yours. But we had to celebrate and rejoice, for this brother of yours was dead and has begun to live, and was lost and has been found.'" This is one of my favorite stories in Scripture. It's one of my favorite stories that Jesus ever told. It's one of his best. And we can look at this from two perspectives. We can either look at it from the perspective of the runaway, the prodigal son, or we can look at it from the point of view of the father, who in this story could be the pursuer. That's exactly how we can look at all these stories that we will be going through for the next few weeks. The runaway or the pursuer, which one are you? But the big question is, are you far from him today? Is this you, or are you still thinking of someone else? How can we genuinely pursue the lost if we ourselves are far away? There's three issues that this young man had. The three issues are, well, the young man was a little, he felt entitled. He felt like he deserved his wealth. Second of all, he was focusing on his circumstances. And thirdly, he was disillusioned about his life. He thought his life would be different once he ran off to be on his own. That's just where he was at. So as we get into this sense of entitlement, I'm going to spend a little time on this because I think we can relate to this really well. The son was a little demanding of his father. He demanded his estate. He said, "Father, give me the estate that you owe me." And the father, of course, gladly did it. He felt entitled to it, the young man did, and maybe he legitimately earned it over time because of all the work he had done growing up, but maybe it just wasn't his time to have it. But nevertheless, the father gave it to him, divided the wealth between them, and the young man went off not a few days later and then squandered it all. And it says on loose living. We don't necessarily know what that looks like. It could have been with the prostitutes, as his brother said, or it could have been just spending it not very well, not taking care of his money, not taking care of the wealth that was divided between him. But more importantly, he felt like it was earned to him. He felt like he deserved his money. I think we can have the same attitude today. I think we as a culture, we as a world, are a little entitled. It's all over my... Whenever I go on Facebook or Twitter or any type of thing, I see a bunch of memes, I see a bunch of videos, I see a bunch of articles all about this idea of entitlement and all about this idea of what we deserve. And so it's even focused upon in relationship articles. And one of those articles I read, the title of that article was, "Why You Deserve Someone Who Will Give You the World and Nothing Less." I'm sitting there thinking as I'm reading that article is, why in the heck do I deserve it? Why in the heck do I deserve a certain person? In my experience, you kind of have to earn those things. And when you go into the workforce, you have to earn that pay raise. You have to earn what you work for. It's not just given to you. You can't just walk up to a girl or a guy and say, "Hey, I like you. I deserve you." If I tried that, I'm pretty sure I'd get a slap in the face and never have any interaction with women at all. It just doesn't go over that well. Have any of you ever tried that? I didn't think so. They won you over, right? You have to build a certain trust. You have to build a relationship. It doesn't work like that. And these articles that I read, such as that one, I never got to the bottom of why I deserve them. Why do I deserve these things? Why does the world think that we're so entitled to the things that we think we deserve? Why? I don't think we'll ever get down to the bottom of it because we just think we're entitled. The heart of the issue is self-focus and personal sin and how we want to live our lives. It's all about me, 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 and me. That's contrary to God's word, though. It's contrary to what He has called us to. I can tell you right now, it's also in political debates. Isn't it? Why people are fighting for certain rights that they shouldn't be fighting for. Some of them being in abortion. Some of them being in the gay marriage issue. And even the legalization of marijuana for some reason. I don't know what's going on with that. In this world today, we apparently have the opportunity, if we are a woman and a life is growing inside of us, we can go to a clinic and have that child removed. Apparently, we have that right. In some states, you can go into the courthouse and marry the same sex. Those are issues that are contrary to God's word. I don't know where we get this idea that we are entitled, besides our focus on self. But if we're really honest, we've all been selfish, we've all been self-focused. And whenever we get to that point, that is when we become far from God. When we start focusing on our own desires, our own personal causes. Now, is there a point where we have to be selfish when we have to take care of ourselves? Yes. There is. There is a point where we have to be able to take care of ourselves. We have to, in a sense, focus on the needs that the Lord, on our needs. But that doesn't mean we live our life selfishly for everything that we want. Because, quite frankly, we can't always get what we want. I think that's in a song somewhere. A Rolling Stone song. But it's there. We've all been selfish. We've all felt entitled to something. We've all felt like we deserve something. But it wasn't just the entitlement that the young man had. He felt he was focusing on his circumstances. His circumstances weren't up to par to the way he wanted to live his life. Jesus' parable is fairly vague on the reason why he was leaving, but I can guess as I was reading it that he wanted his own independence. He wanted to have his own life. And there's nothing inherently wrong with wrong with having your independence. I mean, I'm the type of person that wants my independence now. I still live with my mom and grandma at this time, but it's also not my time to be going off on my own. And it may not have been his time to go off on his own, especially since he wasted his wealth. He wanted his own independence, but he wasn't ready. And he began focusing on his negative outcomes. He didn't have the food that he used to have. He was, you know, wanting to eat the pods the swine were eating. That sounds disgusting, but he was focusing on his negative circumstances. And I personally am one to start focusing on the negative outcomes. I start wondering, oh no, this is, if especially if a negative circumstance is coming up, such as financial issues. How am I going to pay for this? How am I going to take care of this? How am I going to take care of that? I start focusing on the negative outcomes. How am I going to be able to pay what I need? Am I going to take care of a certain problem? I tend to focus on those things instead of on the outcomes that the Lord would have me focus on. And whenever we start focusing on those negative outcomes, that's also a possibility of us becoming far from our Heavenly Father. We cannot focus on our negative circumstances, because if we focus on our negative circumstances, we will end up making terrible decisions. Finally, this young man was a little disillusioned about his life. He thought his life would be way different when he left to go on his own. He thought he would, he would be able to keep his wealth, but instead he wasted it on loose living. He threw it all away to live the way he wanted, to live the life that he envisioned for himself. Have you ever been in that place that you're thinking that your life would be different if you would have done this? I know I was. I've been there. In fact, I'll get another little bit about me. You're going to learn a little bit. When I went to college, I started going to college in 2008, straight out of high school. I graduated in 2013. Going into college, I was that type of guy. I was thinking I was going to be the type of guy that once I graduated, I would get a... I was going to school for ministry work, by the way, for pastoral ministry. And guess what? I thought I would get a job straight out of college. That didn't happen. I thought I would grow spiritually. Yes, that happened. I thought that maybe I would have a little bit more experience under my belt, and I had some, but not to the point where I wanted. And my chance, I was hoping, praying, thinking maybe I would find a wife in college, and guess what? That didn't happen. God had different plans. I know there was a point in my college experience where I began dwindling spiritually and excelling academically, though. Dwindling spiritually was the worst thing that could have happened, though. It was my sophomore year of college, and I started building a relationship with someone that I probably shouldn't have built a relationship with there. And I started drifting from the Lord, drifting because it became about me, it became about my needs, and, and everything else. It just wasn't good. You wouldn't think that those type of things would happen at a Christian college. They sometimes happen worse. It's way worse sometimes there, and after the breakup or whatever I was going through then, my spiritual life went downhill, and people tell me when they remind me of this that you lost your joy, Sean. You lost your drive. We didn't know what was going on with you. We thought you were depressed. Well, I was. I was all of these things. I was not focused. Because I thought things would have been different at that point. I had my own idea what my life would look like, and it was not up to par. It was not a part of my I was once again focusing on my circumstances. I was selfish. I was disillusioned. I was all three of those things that the prodigal son is in this story, all in one semester. Luckily, the Lord brought me through it, though. I eventually, once that season passed, I don't remember exactly how it passed. I just know that it did. Sometimes time, it does heal things, and you have to allow time to take over. And that was my experience in that motion. And luckily, the Lord brought me home. Lord, and the way my life is now, I mean, like I said, I had my own vision of what my life would look like. Yes, some of those things happened in college. Like, I grew spiritually, and I grew. I came here. I came here to Topeka, and I met you all. I am a part of this church. I get a chance to be a part of this church as an intern. I've been able to lead worship a couple of times. Been able to teach Sunday school class. I mean, I'm getting experience. As the Lord had different plans. So as you can see, disillusionment, focus on circumstances, and feeling like we deserve everything keeps us far from the Lord. And it did that for me. That's what happened to this young man in this story. But of course, Jesus always has a redemption factor in his stories. Well, not always. Some of them aren't so pretty, but this one is one that is. He says, the son came to his senses. And when he came home, the father was waiting for him. Now, I want us to, this is about almost a 6-minute video that we're about to show, but this is a contemporary example of someone who is far from the Lord. And we're actually going to look at it from perspective of an adulterous and unfaithful wife. So let's take a look at the video.
For multiple generations, the men in my family left their wives. The word love was a fictitious thing, something that only happened in fairy tales. As a child, we moved 11 times. Isolation was inevitable. I developed a numbness deep inside of me, a place to go whenever I felt alone. I had friends, but I always kept a safe distance. I was afraid of being loved, afraid of being wholly known. In college, love took on a different meaning. Love seemed like an adventure, a new frontier to explore. I fell for a man and slipped into an abusive relationship. Physically, emotionally, sexually. I crawled deeper into my numb place. Love wasn't dependable. Love was weakness. Right after college, I met Paul. I wasn't interested in any more romantic relationships. I liked my independence. But he was steadfast and disciplined with a heart after God. He was the first man I ever encountered in my life that I wanted to follow. We got married a little over a year later. But there were still places inside of me that were locked up tight. I didn't feel safe enough to open that part up to anyone. So for 3.5 years, we busied ourselves with activity, and I kept my secrets hidden. Somewhere in the process, not fully trusting my husband's love, not fully trusting God's love, we drifted. We became like roommates. I started daydreaming what it would be like to not be married, to be free. So I took my wedding ring off, and 4 months later, my husband hadn't even noticed. that was it. I just stopped being married. I told him I was leaving, and 2 days later, I moved out. Within a week of us separating, I met another man and quickly got into a relationship with him. I met with a divorce lawyer, and from there, I spiraled. I knew God, I knew better, but I believed my life was not recoverable. I'd gone too far. I wasn't worth being loved. During that time, I started coming to Crossroads. I'd sit in the back, singing the song, "You Make Beautiful Things." Could God really make something beautiful out of me? An adulterous woman sitting alone in the dark. I felt God say, "Give up that other relationship, no ties, go back to your husband." But I was scared and numb. I wasn't sure I was ready to live in God's love to deal with the pain of the past. 7 months went by. When I finally found the courage to end my affair, I chose to trust that God had a plan. I texted my husband, strictly out of obedience, and said, "Can I come home?" My husband welcomed me home. He forgave me. God showed me that His love is faithful. And when I experienced that kind of forgiveness from God and from my husband without deserving it, that's love. It wasn't easy, but over time, God softened my heart and totally changed the way I saw my husband. I learned how to receive love and how to give it back. I learned how to fully love my husband. Today, I look at Paul and I am so grateful for what we have. I no longer want some fairy tale. I want what I have, raw, forged through the fire, real love. A kind of love that forgives. A love that grows through perseverance. A pure love that only comes from God. Now I know the meaning of true love.
If that isn't powerful, I don't know what is. That's a real story. That's a story that a Crossroads Church, I think was the name of it, I saw in the YouTube video. And they apparently have stories like that they share publicly. And that's just a beautiful story. Like the woman in that story, in the video, she was far like the prodigal son. It's a beautiful story of redemption, and the husband was, in a sense, waiting. He obviously, if he saw this text from her and hearing, "Can I come home?" He obviously was waiting. He was the faithful one. She wasn't, but she asked, "Can I come home?" And the relationship was completely redeemed. That broke me when I first saw that. I'm one who's... I've been far from God, back and forth all my life, and I think that's the way life is. Sometimes when sometimes as a Christian, that's when you can... because you get into a bubble. You get into this idea that you have your Christian friends, you have your Christian music, you have your Bible, you have it all together, but in a sense, when you have all these things surrounding you, you become numb to that. It's not new to you anymore. And I don't think God wants us to be completely numb to His presence. He wants us to be in His presence daily. So no matter how far you have fallen, No matter how far you have run from him, he has been waiting for you. He has been pursuing you. He is still doing that today. He wants to make the messed up life that we have into his own image. He wants to make it into something beautiful. He wants to change it and rearrange it completely. So again, have you been running from him? Do you feel like he is far away or that you are far away? I want you to know he's calling you home. But are you willing to come home? Are you willing to ask, can I come home? If that's you today, this is a message that I think we all need to hear. This is a message that I've needed to hear. This is the message that the Lord has laid on my heart. So, what do we do with this? If we are feeling entitled to the things that we want or desire, don't demand from God. Ask. But be prepared for the answer to be no on certain things. Sometimes the answer is no. We don't like to hear the word no in this society. We want things done our way. We throw temper tantrums. No wonder he calls us like little children, like stupid sheep. We cannot demand from the Lord. So when it comes to those things, be in prayer with the Lord. Be in prayer with him daily. Prayer is important. Prayer is conversation. Prayer, I can't say that enough. Prayer is communication. Prayer is conversation. I can say that over and over again. And sometimes I can get the head knowledge, but I don't have the heart knowledge. Do you believe that you are having a conversation with the Lord when you are praying? Ask from the Lord. If you're having difficult circumstances, now's the time to maybe lay those things out before the Lord. If something is difficult, like financially, seek help from people who understand finances. Or maybe even confess those things to people in this church. I think, as we have been sharing today, we are in a safe place. We are in a church with people who love others. We are in a church that wants to hear people's stories, who wants to be there for people, who wants to listen to every little thing, well, maybe not every little thing, but to most things, to seek out people to love on. If this is a time to seek people in this church to talk to and be real with, this is a place for that. If you're disillusioned about your life, let's take action and maybe pray about why you feel that way. Now is the time to recognize where you are at with the Lord. So as we conclude, there's going to be an audio song playing called Beautiful Things, the same song that the woman basically rededicated her life to. While that song is praying, the altar is open. You don't have to stand and sing or anything, but the altar is open. This is a place where you can lay your face before the Lord, lay your burdens before the Lord. But if that isn't on your heart, I encourage you to go to maybe Pastor Sean and maybe some other leaders that you trust in this church, or maybe your closest friends who are sitting with you in the pews, and just have a conversation about what you are going through. No matter what you are going through, this is a safe place. And as we play this song, that's what this invitation is about. Now is the time to do business with the Lord. And maybe you've come here today and you haven't heard anything about Jesus Christ. Maybe this is a time to make a decision for the Lord and invite him into your life. So let's do business with the Lord. Let's let him lead us as we sing, as the song plays.
Church at